Hi, this is Vanessa Marshall, voice of Hera and Rook Cast, and you're listening to Dennis and Jay on Podcast Stardust. Their behavior is continually unexpected.
This is Podcast Stardust.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe.
With Dennis Keithley and Jay Krebs.
Your behavior is continually unexpected.
The galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion.
Now witness the firepower of this fully armed and operational battle station.
Welcome to Podcast Stardust. This is the fully armed and operational podcast dedicated to Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion. I'm Dennis Keithley.
And I'm Jay Krebs.
On this episode, we'll be discussing episode 18 of season 3 of Rebels, which is called Secret Cargo. But before we get into Rebels, Jay, where can everybody find us around the internet?
We can be easily found on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust.
All right. The dish is aligned. The signal's boosted to maximum output. The shield is down, and we are now broadcasting the galaxy. This is our full spoiler review of Secret Cargo. And Jay, you want to go ahead and give us a summary of the episode?
My pleasure as always. Hera unexpectedly finds herself attempting to bring Senator Mon Mothma to safety after the Empire intercepts a refueling operation. After the rebels take refuge in a nearby nebula, Grand Admiral Thrawn correctly anticipates their tactics and sends a TIE Defender, Governor Price, and a pair of Star Destroyers to intercept her. Hera manages to successfully evade the Empire while Ezra and Gold Squadron hold off the Imperial fighters in their Y-Wings. Once they have made their escape, Mon Mothma broadcasts a speech to rebel cells across the galaxy calling for an alliance. She is answered by the arrival of a rebel fleet as the episode concludes.
Indeed. So it is a formational episode here for Rebels. What did you think about this one?
This was a great one to revisit because with the release of Rogue One being right around this time as well, you get to see the true origins of the rebel cells kind of converging together for the first time in this rebel fleet. And it's happening in an animated show, which I think is just so cool. So, you know, Rebels has always been at the forefront of tying these threads together between what happened, you know, in the rebellion itself and then how it was formed and then into A New Hope. And this is just, again, just like putting that bridge across and getting to see Mon Mothma in the animated version here and just everything that was at stake. I can't say enough about this episode. It's so great. But what'd you think?
Well, the bulk of this episode takes place in space while everyone is at the controls of a starfighter or the Ghost or something like that. And when I finished watching it, I was like, you know what? This has got me even more excited for the potential of a Rogue Squadron movie than I was before. Because it's just, well, I mean, it's Y-Wings. It's not X-Wings, which is what a lot of Rogue Squadron was. But just that whole, and they weren't even the most dynamic dogfighting starship battles type of thing, but just that game that they were playing in there and how it all worked out. And there was just the pilot chatter and stuff like that. And it wasn't even the most in-depth pilot chatter, but it's like, this could really, really, you know, foretell some incredible stuff for the Rogue Squadron movie. So that was my first reaction after I saw this one, or rewatched, I should say. And I really enjoyed it. It's a fun episode. I didn't remember that much about it, except for how it ended. I didn't remember all the details in the middle, but there's some really interesting details to this one. But that said, it all starts off with Hera, Ezra, Chopper, and Zeb in the Ghost, and they are waiting for an unknown contact, and they're going to be in charge of refueling. And what's interesting is that the debris field that they're in is, if you look at the details of some of the stuff, it is the remnants of, looks like, a Separatist fleet from the Clone Wars there that just happens to be in space. And so it's become some sort of a smuggler's hideout or station for doing their missions. Did you pick up on that?
No, I didn't. That's super cool. And there's all these wonderful little Easter eggs that are embedded in all of these episodes. And this one's got quite a few, but I definitely didn't pick up on that. That's really cool.
Right. So while they're killing time, Zeb and Ezra are watching the holo news, and it's mainly some Imperial coming on and talking about things. But then there is a spot that is kind of foreshadowing that has footage of Mon Mothma denouncing Emperor Palpatine, and she directly connects him to the Gorman massacre, which is another one of these things that Rebels lifted from Legends, and specifically the 1990s Rebels Alliance sourcebook, which is an RPG supplement. And it was described as an incident, inciting incident of Imperial brutality that inspired a lot of people to rebel. So Mon Mothma goes so far as to call the Emperor the lying executioner and a self-appointed emperor. I mean, she's not pulling her punches here at all.
No, she's really not. And Zeb even says, like, you know, I can't believe she's going to be still alive after this. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, she's definitely laying it out on the line there. But again, this whole Gorman massacre thing that you pointed out, I never would have known this either. But for those that have any kind of an inkling of what that is, I'm sure that that perks up their ears and is something I truly appreciate about what they do in this. It's so gratifying.
Mm-hmm. So the Rebel contacts start to arrive, and it is a number of Y-Wings, and it happens to be the Y-Wings that Sabine, Ezra, and the rest of the team stole earlier in the season.
Yeah.
And so that's cool. They've been upgraded a little bit, and they need to be refueled. And then there's a transport that docks with the Ghost, and an aide comes aboard, and no one on the Ghost is allowed to get onto this transport. But we also get the series debut of John Dutch Vander, better known as Gold Leader from A New Hope, who was voiced by Angus McGinnis and is now being voiced by Yuri Lowenthal. So that was a nice cameo, is not quite right because he's in a significant portion of this episode, but that was a nice tie-in between Rebels and A New Hope.
Oh, for sure. And again, this is just one of those things that I just think is so stunning about the series and the way that they interpret these live action from all the way back from 1977 and integrate it right here. And because that, I was watching this again with my husband and I said, yeah, this is Gold Leader, you know, from the Trench Run. And he's like, wait, who? I said, yeah, Gold Leader, you know, just saying it just like that, because that's how I remember his voice in my head, you know? And so again, it's just super cool. I love it.
This is Gold Leader, right? Yep. it's unmistakable. Not sure that I can do an imitation, but there it is. So they come aboard the Ghost, and there is another Y-Wing pilot. And there's this discussion about how the Phoenix Squadron and those Rebels blew up a Star Destroyer. And this Rebel pilot, it's not Vander, but is really quite annoyed by that, because she's like, you guys are being careless, and now that's made things more difficult for the rest of us everywhere. And I guess my response to that is like, well, they can't exactly be picky and choosy about all the time about when they destroy Star Destroyers. Sometimes you just got to do what you got to do here.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. And taking sides in the rebellion is not going to help anybody either.
Mm-hmm. And there was this fear. We completely skipped over this part, but while they were waiting for the Rebel fleet to show up, one of those infiltrator droids that Zeb had to deal with at Chopper Base shows up in a pod and starts scanning everything. Although they destroy this droid and his pod, they're pretty certain that it got the word off to the Empire that they're there. And sure enough, the Empire shows up and it begins attacking the transport, damages it significantly enough that the transport has to be abandoned. And that's when they learn that the top secret cargo on the transport is none other than Senator Mon Mothma herself. And she is being voiced by Genevieve O'Reilly, who portrayed Mon Mothma in, or was going to like portray her in Revenge of the Sith. Those scenes got cut, but then also portrayed her in Rogue One. So we get her back in this role. What did you think about her appearance?
Oh, so perfect. And I mean, it's just definitely placed just right, because as I was saying at the top of the episode, just the way that this ties directly into Rogue One, you know, and bringing the real life actor into the voice role of this is just perfect. I mean, it couldn't be more perfect.
Yep. And then she's going to be back in Kenobi, in the Kenobi series as well. So we'll get to see more of her very soon. Yes. So really good timing on our parts. Pat ourselves in the back. So So she kind of jumps right into the fray and starts helping restore some of the systems on the Ghost, and so they can get out of there. And she has to release the latch because they can't disconnect from the transport. So she has to do that manually. So Hera now has to smuggle Mon Mothma out from underneath the Empire's nose, and they seek refuge in a nearby nebula, which has got a lot of protostars forming in it. And it's a very dangerous place. A lot of smugglers use this to evade the Empire. But word gets back to Grand Admiral Thrawn about what's happened, and he correctly predicts that this is what they're going to do. And so he comes up with this plan. It's kind of funny. I read the notes, and it sounds like it's a TIE Defender, two Star Destroyers, and Governor Price. Like, she's floating out there in space. Not exactly the most artfully written thing I've ever done. But at any rate, so she's going to command this expedition to snuff out Mon Mothma here. And so they do. They show up there, and they dispatch this TIE Defender, which is the first time we get to see a TIE Defender in action. And it's being flown by Commander Volt Scaris. And he just starts laying waste to these Y-Wings, showing how formidable a fighter the Defender is and how much of a problem it's going to be for the Rebellion if they actually get these things into full-scale production and deployed out in the field.
Right. And even Ezra says, well, when did they get hyperspace drives? You know, so it was really a surprising thing for them. And, you know, it did take them by storm, you know, pun intended, I guess. And, you know, how great was that? Of course, Grand Admiral Thrawn knew exactly what they were going to do, you know, and he even mentioned something along the lines of, you know, they don't think that we're, you know, going to look into this, and that's exactly what we need to do. So, right. You know, the statistician, or tatistician, I should say, at his best once again.
Yeah. And again, this was an effective use of the character. I don't know that Thrawn is always used to his best, because we're all expecting what we saw from him in the Heir to the Empire trilogy, where he's learning all these things about various alien species by studying their art and predicting what they're going to do after evaluating their version of the Mona Lisa or whatever it might be. But it doesn't always ring true. It's just kind of like, how can you possibly know that? But this is something that he would know. This would be something that he would be able to figure out based on data and intel. Doesn't have to analyze a piece of an art to get there. So I do appreciate scenes like that where we can see how smart he actually is.
Exactly. And backing up for just a second too, I guess one more thing I would say about Mon Mothma, and speaking of, you know, a good use of the character, is that I know this really portrays her as I feel she truly is. And because I just know from the original movies, you know, Return of the Jedi specifically, where she's talking about many Bothans died to bring us this information. She always just seemed like this really fragile sort of, you know, leader kind of a thing. And you didn't really see that tougher side of her. Right. And so her calling out the Emperor and then, you know, working with Hera to like try to nail down the ship and get things going, and just her moxie in this, I think, is just awesome. Because you don't even really see that. I mean, a little bit in Rogue One, but not as much as you even do here in this episode. So I just thought that was very, very cool.
Yeah, to your point, it's episodes like this that justify why she's such a revered person. When you get to Rogue One and then later in Return of the Jedi. And it's been things like this appearance in Rebels and then other novel appearances that she's really earned the respect of everyone else in the Rebellion. So that's a good point. But then the other thing I was going to ask you is, like, again, I know I harp a lot on this when it comes to these Rebel episodes that Thrawn shows up in, but I just keep having more and more trouble every time I rewatch an episode of Rebels with Thrawn in it, kind of reconciling this character with the one that showed up in the novels that Timothy Zahn wrote. Mm-hmm. They just don't seem like the same guy when it comes to their altruism or, you know, those type of qualities where, you know, he had a very honorable and noble purpose in those books, but we're supposed to believe he carried it forward with him into this series, but he really just seems super committed to serving the Empire here and not so concerned about freedom in the galaxy.
Right. And, you know, and I agree with you on that one. And I guess the way that I try to reconcile it is I try not to get too caught up in trying to make that particular piece of continuity happen. Mm-hmm. And because I feel like I'm trying a little too hard with that. And I dislike that because we see so much more cohesiveness in just about every other character. But you're right. There's a real disconnect there. And it just doesn't resonate the way that I feel like it should. So mm-hmm. I do tend to see Rebels Thrawn just almost as a different character, which I don't like saying because it shouldn't feel that way. But yet it is.
Yeah. Well, who knows? I mean, there's lots of rumors out there that he's going to be the villain in the Ahsoka series. And maybe when we get to that, there'll be something there that really ties together this character from both Rebels and from the novels that Zahn mm-hmm. wrote. And so I'm looking forward to that. And if it's not the case, it's not the case. He'll still be fun to watch. And don't get me wrong, it's, even though there is this disconnect, as you put it, between the two, I still enjoy him as a character. And it's one of those things that you can almost write off as these are different stories being told from different points of view. So this is someone mm-hmm. else's take on it. I know that's what Pablo Hidalgo likes to say. And so maybe he just was a bit more cold and calculating in the eyes of the rebellion, because why would they have warm and fuzzy feelings about him?
True. Yeah. And that's kind of the lens that we're looking through in this series. I guess if we want to put it in that sense of the word, that this is called Star Wars Rebels. So we're going to see him in that lens once again.
Right. So during the Imperial pursuit through the nebula, Hera managed to lose a number of the Imperial fighters. And these are some TIE interceptors, by getting really close to one of the protostars. You know, she puts the shields up and they basically get a little cooked, but the TIE interceptors get destroyed. The TIE defender has to peel off because it's being get overheated. But Hera makes it out of the nebula, but she doesn't have any power. And then the two Star Destroyers with Governor Price aboard arrive. And before the Empire can catch them in the tractor beam, Ezra and Dutch emerge from the nebula. They have used their ion cannons to stop Volt-Scaris and his TIE defender, but they use their torpedoes to create an interaction in the nebula that basically completely knocks out and disables the two Star Destroyers. I really like that scene. I thought that was really cool, the way that turned out. And I think it kind of speaks to a blind spot in Thrawn's tactics here. He did the right thing by sending this group out after Hera and Mon Mothma, but he trusted them to understand the perils of the location they were in. Mm-hmm. I don't think Thrawn would have gotten caught in that trap.
No, I agree with that. And, you know, I guess it just goes to show that the rebellion, especially Hera, she's willing to put it all on the line. You know, she's willing to even risk the ghost for, you know, the sake of the greater good, which she was obviously trying to get Mon Mothma to where she needed to go, because that was the whole purpose in the first place. But yeah, I definitely, you know, especially the first time, didn't really see that coming, but it was, mm-hmm. it was a pretty savvy little move for sure.
So this allows them to get away, and they get to the point that they need to get at, and they begin their broadcast. Mon Mothma makes her speech where she resigns from the Senate to fight on behalf of everyone there. And she's going to fight until the Republic is restored. And she basically asks, "Are you with me?" And this speech is being broadcast all over the place. We get all kinds of different people from Lothal and other worlds that are listening in. And I remember watching this for the first time, I was like, that's a really weird thing to end your speech with to the galaxy. But it seems like it was kind of staged to a bit, because there was all these ships must have been on standby waiting to hyperspace in for this big show of unity. Mm-hmm. But how did you take that? What was your impression?
Oh, it was just super cool, you know, because it was just this way of broadcasting to everyone to say, hey, look, we can do this. We can stand up against this. And are you with me? It's very inspiring. And it's just super cool. Every time you see all of the ships coming out of hyperspace like that, no matter whether it's in this episode or in things like in Rogue One or in The Rise of Skywalker, you know, that's just always hits in the feels when you see that, you know, all those ships coming in. So I just think it was a really poignant way to end that episode.
Right. And it's our first time seeing a Mon Calamari cruiser in Rebels. Yes. And it was home one. So Ackbar's ship. Wonder if he was on board. That's really cool. No Raddus, but we can live without that for this episode. We also get to see the Nebulan B frigates in the service of the rebellion for the first time as well. And so that was pretty cool. And then if you watch the Rebels Recon, and it's on the episode guide on StarWars.com for this episode, they're talking to various creators, and you know, Pablo Hidalgo is making this point that this is a very historical moment, kind of like you were saying, for the rebellion. This is where they first come together as an alliance. And a lot of the ships that show up there are the ships that will go on to fight at Scarif. And then some of them will go to fight at the Battle of Endor as well. Mm-hmm. So this is huge. I'm not sure that in passing, a lot of Star Wars fans realize that, but with that backdrop, it just makes this episode even more impressive and important.
Oh yeah. And I don't even know if nostalgia is necessarily the word that I would use for that, but it hits in all the feels, because it just gives you sort of that like cohesive, like hit home sort of a feeling. Yeah. It's really cool.
And you really realize how much Phoenix Squadron, Hera, and the rest of them were important to the formation of the rebellion.
Right. Well, and just like with Rogue One in general, it's funny because I was just having this conversation with some students of mine today about, because one of them asked me, oh, what's your favorite Star Wars movie? Because, you know, of course, they all know how much I love it. Mm-hmm. And my answer is always, oh, it depends on what day you ask me. And I said, but you know what? Rogue One probably stands out. And so we were talking about that. And even the kids are saying, yeah, you don't really appreciate how much of a sacrifice was made when you watch A New Hope until you watch Rogue One. And those are my sentiments exactly. So this is something that digs even further into that, you know, sentimentality almost of what the rebellion was all about and what really was at stake at the time, which I think is awesome.
Indeed. Very well said. All right. Well, then I think that brings us to the end of our discussion of Secret Cargo. I'd like to thank you all for listening to this episode of Podcast Stardust. We hope you enjoyed the episode, and if you did, please make sure to subscribe to Podcast Stardust on your podcatcher of choice. I'd like to remind you that you can find all episodes of the podcast over at RetroZap.com, which is home to several other great podcasts covering everything from the MCU and DC to Dune, Star Trek, collecting, and a whole lot more. As always, we greatly appreciate 5-star ratings and reviews on your podcatcher, whichever one that might be, but especially if it's Apple Podcasts. And don't forget to share the show and your favorite episodes on social media with your friends. Speaking of which, Jay, can you remind everybody what those social media contacts are once again?
Absolutely. We are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. And we do have a Pinterest board and a YouTube channel where you can catch all of our past episodes as well as our unboxing videos. And we are on Discord. So if you want to catch us for some real-time chatter, just head over to our Discord room. We are just one of many rooms over on the Wretches Up Discord server. So if you go to our community page and click on our show tab, it'll take you right to where you need to go. And we also have a TeePublic store where we are teepublic.com/user/podcaststardust, and you can pick up a bunch of different products with your choice of 7 different show logo designs available on everything from t-shirts, sweatshirts, coffee mugs, mouse pads, stickers, magnets, all kinds of fun stuff. And they're always having some good sales, so you just have to check that out, and also check out our Instagram, because I do try to post that kind of stuff there as well. So with that, Dennis, why don't you let everybody know what you've got going on with your podcast Warp Trails?
Sure. Warp Trails is the podcast devoted to the new Star Trek shows over on Paramount Plus. I host that with my wife, Beth, and we are currently wrapping up season 4 of Discovery, and we are getting close to the end of season 2 of Picard, getting ready to start our coverage of Strange New Worlds, which picks up in May. And then we will be getting into the season 3 of Lower Decks this year. So if you're into any of those Star Trek shows, head on over to the RetroZap podcast feed on your podcatcher choice and check us out. Jay, let everybody know what's going on with your cosplay.
Well, as usual, you can always catch me over on my Instagram, which is at j.snipscosplay. And right now I am fully prepping and getting my Hera operational. So speaking of Hera and the Rebellion, you'll be getting to see me sporting that cosplay very, very soon. So I'm just about done with that. And I'm so proud of all of the things that I've learned along the way with that as well. And I'll tell you, I really learned a lot of that through following other cosplayers as well. So it's just a really fun community over there. And of course, you can always catch me as Ahsoka on Tano Tuesdays. And so again, just check that out at j.snipscosplay.
All right, that'll do it for episode 404 of Podcast Stardust. Thanks for listening, everyone. And until next time, may the Force be with you.